I want to welcome you here tonight. We're gathered together for one reason. One reason only. What is it?
Praise the Lord!
Come on, don't be shy. Lift up Jesus, yes. And the power of His might will sanctify you to an end. You can't hear me? Boy, that's unusual for me. My mother told me to shut up when I was 3. I've been trying to shut up ever since. Anyway, I got my belly up against this thing called a, I don't know what it's called, but I need to tell you a few things here to make it look good. We have a prayer box here, right down here, and if you wish to put a write a prayer request out, come and put it in the prayer box. George is going to pray for it later. He promised. Wait, George? Yeah. George promised. Our next business meeting and prayer meeting will be at Jack Dominic's place.
I'll be there. He's there.
Yeah.
Would Jack Dominic stand?
Jack is Dominic. I mean Jack. Yes. Jack. His place is at 702 Fred Street in Sudbury. Preet? You'd almost think I couldn't read the English language here. But I got that down here. Preet Street. Okay, Jack. Our next banquet is going to be on January the 20th. That's in 2023. Okay. I want to make sure. And that's going to be here in the Northbury. We're even going to invite a speaker. Of course, Jeannie. Was that you? Oh, Lorraine, sure. His name is David White. Anybody know him? Oh, one? Where's he from? To be quite honest with you, I don't know.
Is that you preaching?
That's the only
David White. He's coming to tell us all about his life, just like we're going to hear from George. Oh, and you know what? Surprise, surprise, you're going to hear from Pauline tonight. She,
yes.
Pauline, that
yes.
She, I was going to say, belongs to George, but George says that he actually belongs to her. I think it's a two-way street here. Anyway, we're going to hear from her later, too. That's enough said. I'm going to ask Jerry to come and give you a little rundown on membership.
Amen.
Come on, Jerry.
Don't get me going. I am a comedian. You know, I have the privilege of getting up here and addressing the men that still are not members here of this organization. We need men to come in. God is going to raise this organization up in the Sudbury region. He gave me dreams and visions of it. And He is starting to bring it to pass. And any man that wants a place to belong, God's going to put us together as brothers like we've never seen before. And we will be there with you, pray with you, encourage you, and challenge you. as members of the, when we meet together, and then you get to know all the members. It's also a place where you can give a small testimony or get to speak at the front. I was a shy man, and God made me an extrovert. That is a big change. So he can change you too, and if you think you're too old, take a look at the head table here.
Oh, yeah.
There's still room for you to do some action here. And God said, when I wanted to retire when I was 65, you know what the Lord said? There's no retiring in my army. He said, you're just going to start to move now. And that's what he wants with all these men. So I'm, what are you going to West? Membership chairman. I'm still not used to this. They just placed me in this position, and you got an opportunity to come and get placed somewhere too. So anyway, see me after if you're interested, and we'll give you the forms and share with you what needs to be done. Thank you.
Now it's your turn. Open up your wallets and dump them on the table. Put them in the basket and we'll pick them up. Honestly, it's never any fun asking for money. You want to come back next month? Anybody want to come back next month? Okay, enough said. Don't have to say anything more. We enjoy you being here. We, as full gospel businessmen and donkeys like me, enjoy you being here. We enjoy having someone like George and Pauline come especially to minister to us. And I don't know how else to say it, but another reason we are here tonight is for those that might not be as close to Jesus Christ as someone else is, I guess. How else do we say it? We're here so that we can tell you about Jesus Christ and the power of Him living inside people, men and women, women and men, people. And He's in the changing of life for anybody that just says yes. And that's why we're here. So if you don't mind, please fill out whatever you can, and we'll pick it up shortly. Thank you very much.
You got a prayer request in here? Did you all put your prayer requests in? Let's all stand tonight as we pray. Whatever these prayer requests are tonight, the Lord already knows. Amen for every one of these. Maybe you prayed for healing. Maybe you prayed for salvation for your son, daughter, someone in your family. You prayed something. You put faith, your faith into action by writing that request on a piece of paper. And it took faith to walk up here and place it in this box. And God's a God that says, I will honor faith. And so, Lord, tonight we come to you, Father. Lord, to a God that says, I hear your cry, I hear your prayer. And I will move and I will act upon that faith that you displayed, that you took, Lord, in taking the time to write it out, to walk up here, to place it in a box, Lord. And God already knew what you were going to be writing. He already knew what that prayer request would be. And so, Father, we lift up every one of them to you tonight. The one that's calling out and asking for healing, Father. Touch and heal that one, Lord. Lord, that's asking for prayer. The one that, Lord, is seeking salvation, deliverance, oh God. Financial need, Lord. Whatever it is, Father, it's in this box. They've placed it there by faith, Lord. And you're a God that honors faith. You hear faith, Lord. And you're a God that, Lord, that will answer it, Father. So, Lord, we just place it in your hands now, Lord, that every one of these are going to be met. Even now, Father, answers are coming, Lord. Hallelujah. Let your people hang on, Lord, until that answer comes. Let them keep pounding, Lord, on the gate of heaven until answers come, Lord. Father, we just ask you now to touch each one, Father, each request, Father, each person that put that request in. Touch them now, Father, and give them assurance, Lord, that yes, the answer's on the way, that Lord, that request will be answered, Lord. We thank you now, Father, as we ask in that mighty name above all names, the name of Jesus, Lord. Amen and amen.
We thank you, Lord. The next two little songs are probably in the pamphlet on the back of it. Thank you.
My name is George Gunner with my wife Pauline. A number of years ago, probably 30 years ago or so, I had pulled a muscle in my my lower back. And anyway, I hobbled around, you know how men are, for a few days. And my wife said, you better go to the hospital. So yeah, I said, well, you got to come with me. You know how brave we are. So she came with me. We went up to the hospital. And you know, they always put you in a little room. So I'm sitting in there. My wife's in there with me. And the doctor walks in. And he says, so who's here to see me? You or your daughter? He checks me out and he says, you know, you're a little, he uses a nice word for saying fat, you're a little bit obese. And I'm sitting there, I'm thinking, he called me fat, he called me old, why don't he just call me ugly and get it over with? Anyway, we're here tonight, my wife is with me, my wife, my beautiful wife, we've been married for how many years, dear? 48 years.
Wow.
Amen. And we have three children, six grandchildren, and two great-grandchildren. So we're getting up there. Okay.
Well, praise the Lord. Amen. It's good to be here with you. And like he said, we've been married for 48 years. We've been saved for 38 years. And we've been in ministry for 33 years. Amen. And just thank the Lord, amen, for saving us. And we are First Nation, and we grew up in Moose Factory, Ontario. And I always remembered when we started dating and thought about getting married. Okay. I always said I didn't want to be like the typical Native family, drinking all weekend and, you know, and he agreed, amen. He said, no, we're not going to do that. And but it just seemed like as soon as we got married, that's what happened. And my mom always taught us that women don't do that. She said, it was okay for the men to go out and drink all weekend. And but just, you know, for women, my mom said, no, that you don't do that. And so I remember that happening. And I remember feeling sorry that I got married and wishing I never got married. And my mom really drilled into us also that once you were married, you know, that was it. You had to stay married. And, you know, although my mom wasn't saved, I really took heed to her words, amen, and listened to her. And but around that time, you know, the full Pentecostal gospel came to our little island. And it just seemed like there was revival. People were getting saved, and I seen people's lives being changed. You know, the people that used to go out partying all weekend, they were quitting that. Amen. And my brother was one of them that got saved. And he'd always come by and invite my mom to church. And my mom knew I was unhappy. Amen. And she went out to, she'd always go out to the services. And one night she came back from the service and she said, you know, she said, you should have came with us to church. She said, there was a man there. And she said, that man just looked like George. And she said, and as I was sitting there, she said, I just felt something in my heart and I was just wishing that that was George up there preaching. And you know, God heard her prayer, amen. I'll just share this little chorus because it's about my mom, amen. Thank you. God. And we moved all the way over there, and that's where we got saved, in Stony Plain, Alberta. And you know, 1 year after we got saved, we moved back home to Moose Factory. And you know, I always remember, you know, it wasn't very long after we moved home. We were only 1 year old in the Lord. And somebody called us and said, I heard that you've moved back here and you're going to be starting a church here. And we laughed. Amen. And you know, 4 years later, that's what we were doing. Amen. We were starting a church on the island of Moose Factory, and God called my husband into ministry. And you know, before he was called into ministry, I always remember this one preacher coming to our community and preaching, and he was talking about the need, amen, for the gospel to go out. And I remember something just burning inside of me, you know, and as he was sharing from Isaiah 6, you know, and in verse 8, where it says, who will go? And I remember reading it, and that part that says, here I am, I'll go. And I remember saying that, you know, and really meaning it, and not really knowing what I was praying and saying, I guess, you know. But you know, we found ourselves in ministry, amen. Like I said, we've been in ministry for 33 years now. My husband started off as a youth pastor, and I always remember that night also, the youth pastor in our church was stepping down. And we lived in Moose Factory, but we went to church in Moosonee. And I don't know if you know the area, but there's a river. Moose Factory's on an island. And we'd cross the river all the time to go to church. And the youth pastor stepped down, and the pastor said, we're going to need a youth pastor. And he was asking for prayer. And so I didn't know that all that night my husband was wrestling with God. But in the morning, he got up, and I was making breakfast, and he said, I'm not eating until I come back. And he said, I got to go over and see the pastor. And I knew what he was going to see the pastor for, and I said, no, you can't go. And I told him, I said, you know what, a pastor needs to know how to preach. You don't even know how to preach. And you know, he never preached, you know, before then. So anyways, he says, well, he said, I have to answer this call. And as soon as he went out the door, you know, I just felt conviction, I guess, and I just fell on my knees. I started praying, and I said, Lord, if you're calling my husband, then I'm going to stand up and I'm going to help him to fulfill that calling that you're placing in his life. And you know, I remember that week, his first service was going to be on the Friday. That week he went out and he went to visit homes on the reserve and inviting people, you know, telling the people. He knew they had teenagers. He said, I've just been appointed to be the youth pastor, and I want to come and pick up your young people and take them over to church. And you know, that night, his first service, you know, 6 young people got saved. And he preached. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, that's the kind of God that we serve. Amen. And you know, since then, well, it was after that, then they decided that they wanted to start a church in Moose Factory, because there were so many of us that were going over to Moosonee, to the mainland. And so they asked my husband if he would look after the church over there if we started one. And so that's how we started pastoring. We built the church there in Moose Factory, and then we even started a Christian day school. And we did that for about 10 years, I guess. And then they asked him, we were sitting under the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada. And then they asked him if he could be the overseer of the native churches that were under the Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada. So we did that, amen. And then that was when we really started traveling, going up into northern communities, you know, flying in northwestern Ontario and everything. And we did that for another 10 years. And then the Lord placed in my husband's heart, he was always saying, I believe the Lord wants us to get out of the Pentecostal Assemblies, and he wants us to start our own ministry, a native ministry. And he kept telling me this, and I said, well, George, we're getting pretty old here. If you're gonna do it, you better do it now. Amen. And we've been doing this since 2014, I believe, that we started the Christian Aboriginal Fellowship of Canada. And you know, the Lord is good, and I notice a lot of us are up there in our years, amen. And you know, I wanted to share that about my mom's prayer. And I believe that prayer is so powerful, and we must begin to pray for our young people, amen, that they will stand up and fulfill, amen, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I believe that hearts can be stirred, amen, as we sit there. Hallelujah. And I just don't know where we'd be if it wasn't for the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We have three children. Two of our children serve the Lord, and they help us in the ministry. Our oldest son lives in Moose Knee, but we have conferences in North Bay. We have a leadership conference, a youth conference, and we have a family conference. So we do three conferences a year, and my oldest son will always come out and help us. But our daughter lives with us in North Bay, and she's just a blessing to have, amen. She helps her dad a lot, you know, and she's very gifted, talented. She can play all the instruments, and she's very techie also, amen. Thank you, Jesus. But what a great God that we serve, amen. I'm always glad that, you know, I said yes to the Lord when I heard the gospel. Thank you, Jesus. And like I said, you know, we were in Moose Factory for most of the years that we were saved until we moved out. We've been in North Bay now for 18 years. And you know, when you live on a reservation, so it was only about the population, 1,500. Everyone knew when somebody got saved. Everyone knew, you know, and there was many times we went through trials and hard times. And you know, and I wouldn't give up because people are watching us, amen. And I wouldn't want to bring shame to our Lord, because you know there's nothing too hard for Him, amen. No matter what we go through, amen, we can keep on going. Hallelujah. And I just thank the Lord, amen, for the ones that went before us, you know, that taught us how to do ministry. You don't do ministry just when you feel like it, amen. You do it even when you don't feel like it, amen. Hallelujah. But I'll just sing this song before my husband comes to share the word.
Oh,
Jesus Christ. I want to share a verse of scripture with you as I just share a little bit of, you know, what the Lord has done for us. And it's in the book of James in the 4th chapter. There's two verses there that I wanted to, the Lord placed upon my heart when Brother Wes called and asked if I could come and just share my testimony. Chapter 4, James, verse number 13. Go to now, you that say today or tomorrow, we'll go to such a city, continue there a year, we'll buy and sell, and we'll get gain, we'll make money. Verse 14 says, whereas you know not what shall be on tomorrow, you don't know what tomorrow holds. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time, and then it's gone, it vanisheth away. Lord, we thank you for your presence here, for everyone that's here tonight. And Lord, as we go to your word now, we ask you, Father, to anoint us, Lord. Anoint these lips of clay, anoint our ears to hear, Father, tonight. And Father, we give you all the praise and the glory. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, I was thinking about this, especially with what's happened in the last couple of years. Many of us, you know, we made plans for our lives, and yet we don't even know what tomorrow holds because of the uncertainty, amen, of the life we're living. And as I said, even more so in the past few years, that we have come to realize that, you know, what's happened. Many made vacation. I heard of people making vacation plans, college plans. As a pastor, there was a lot of young people were making wedding plans, and they were all excited. But when the pandemic hit us, it changed everything. Amen. A lot of things that took place. Some of us lost even jobs we had and everything that just changed. This whole world even came to a place where we never thought we'd see what happened take place, where it was totally shut down. Amen. All, you know, you call the seven spheres of influence. I've been looking at that, the education, the entertainment, the sports, the business world, the government, even our churches, amen, were all shut down by this pandemic. Many plans had to change, and some sadly had to turn to funeral plans. Many people lost loved ones, amen, that were unexpected because of this virus that hit us. And so this pandemic had a powerful impact. On many people had a negative impact. And yet, despite everything that's happened, we are serving a God who is not uncertain of what is happening. That's the certainty that we have in this world. We have a God who knows exactly what's going to happen, when it's going to happen, and how long it's going to happen. We're serving a God tonight, amen, that is in control of everything. And although the pandemic may have seemed to cause humans unawares or off guard, it did not catch God unaware. God knew exactly what was going to be happening. Amen. He's the one that's in control. He was very much aware of everything. And what we're seeing, amen, in this world right now is God's plan unfolding for every one of us here. And the church was supposed to be brought closer to Jesus, amen, through all of this. Do you know that every Christian should have been closer now, more intimate with the Lord now than ever before, than even before the pandemic? I believe the purpose of that pandemic was to draw God's people closer to Jesus. Many of us were drifting away from the Lord. Amen. It's not a truck convoy that's going to bring revival to our land. Come on. Amen. But it's, I believe, men and women who are in close, intimate relationship with the living God. Amen. Who believe in the word of Almighty God. I believe the word of God is what's going to bring this revival into the land. But many people, amen, get offended by the word. You know why? Because it offends lifestyles. It offends the way you're living. So we don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear the word. We say, don't preach the word to me, brother. Tell me the good things. But it's the word that needs to come forth in the midst of us. Hallelujah. How many believe that tonight? And so when this pandemic ended, we ought to have come back with a louder shout, with a greater praise. We ought to have come back with a deeper worship and a more powerful anointing than we ever had before.
The Bible says in the book of Jeremiah, my ways are not your ways. We don't understand this. Yet God was working in the midst of us, trying to bring his church closer unto him. He had plans for us. But see, so does the devil. Satan has a plan for your life. Satan has plans for your life. Satan had a plan for my life. He had a plan for my mom and dad. He had a plan for my family. Amen. We were raised in poverty. We grew up in poverty. That's all I knew. Amen. As a young boy, I knew violence. I knew drunkenness. I knew parties. That's all I knew. As a young boy, I knew what it was to be hungry. Amen. On different days when there wasn't enough food. Amen. To go around. We were living in poverty. Satan desires to steal, kill, and to destroy. That's his plan. Amen. And so he had our family in this place of violence. See, Satan had a plan to kill Joseph, amen, in Egypt. He had a plan to kill Job and his family and destroy them completely. He even had a plan to take Jesus out. How many know that? Amen. But God had a better way, because God always has the final say. Joseph at the end says what he meant for evil, God meant for good. And God would use Joseph, amen, to spare the Israelites from a famine that was in the land. Do you know there's a famine in the land tonight? There's a famine of the Word of God. There's not enough of the Word of God going on. And people are running around starving because of the lack of the Word of God. The Bible says, amen, that Job, at the end of his trial, said, hey, he gave me twice as much as I had before. God is getting us ready to put you in a place where you're going to have twice as much as what you ever had before. You see, he took Jesus and crucified him and put him on that cross. He dies, amen, and he's buried. But what Satan didn't know is God always has the final say. Because on that third resurrection morning, Jesus would walk out of a grave and declare, I was dead, but now I'm alive forevermore. Satan didn't know what he was doing. The Bible says, had he known, he would not have done what he did. He would not have crucified the Son of Glory. Pauline and I were married at a very young age. Very young. And I always desired to have a better life than what I grew up in. That was my desire. I didn't want to be poor. I didn't want to live in poverty all my life. And I wanted something from this life. And I was going to make it on my own. And so I got my education. I went to school. I went to college. I got my tickets, amen, for everything. I still have them, my motor vehicle mechanics license, my diesel. I've got my heavy equipment. We moved to Stony Plain, Alberta. Amen. And I got a good job. Amen. I was making good money back in the 80s. Amen. We bought a house and I thought, here, I'm on my way. Success. This is what I wanted, Lord. I'm not going to live in poverty. I'm doing it. Amen. I'm making money. I got money in the bank. We can go where we want. We can have holidays. We can, amen, buy whatever we need to buy. I had a truck, had a car. Hey, got it made. But there was something missing. I didn't know what was missing in my life. And I didn't realize I was running away from God. I remember, amen, when Pauline and I got married, they would have a camp meeting right next door to where we lived, her mom and dad's house. And they would put up this big tent. And I knew there was something about that place, amen, that made me afraid. And I remember telling Pauline, I said, don't you go over there. Because those people are crazy. And you know what? After all those years, I found out they were crazy. Hallelujah. Amen. That's the craziest bunch you can ever find in town. Get into a full gospel church. Get into a Holy Ghost meeting. You're going to find some crazy people. There's people there, oh my Lord, you don't know what's going to happen. I remember one conference, amen, people were rolling. I was looking at them, rolling on the floor, rolling on the floor. What's going on? Well, that's why they call us holy rollers. Hallelujah. I didn't know that. But that's the place, amen. I was afraid of something that was happening there. And I would warn Polly, don't go there. But when we moved out to Stony Plain, Alberta, amen, I began to meet the same crowd I was trying to get away from. And these guys, amen, they were partiers as well. And I began to be involved more and more, drink more and more. As a matter of fact, we were drinking every day now. Every day I would have beer. every day, amen. We go to mine, I was working in a mine, a coal mine, amen. Ice cold beer after work, amen. Going home, amen. And we pick up a 6-pack of beer, finish it off on the way home. One day, I drank a little bit too much. And I rolled through a stop sign. And all of a sudden, red lights came on behind me. I knew what that was. And I hated that when he said, get out of the car and walk. He put this little line in front of me and said, walk this line, walk that line. Oh my goodness, I couldn't walk that line. They put me in the cell for an hour, they said. But that's when God spoke to me. I remember, I didn't know then it was God, but I knew something spoke to me. I was sitting in that cell looking through the bars of that cell. And all of a sudden, this question came and said, where are you leading your children? And that hit me like that, because I knew where I was leading them. The life I was leading was the life my grandfather led and my father led, and I was leading, and my children were going to be leading that same life. I was leading them down the same track. Amen. My parents, my grandparents, my great-grandparents, I was leading them down that same path. And I knew in that moment I needed to find a way, an answer. I needed, amen, to something, amen, to get me out of there. 1 month, amen, I remember 1 month, amen, after that all happened, I went to the first gospel service I ever heard. Guess who was preaching? R.W. Shambach. How many know him? I'm sitting in Edmonton in a big church. They had it via a live stream thing. They had a big, he wasn't there live, but they had him live. And I was sitting there listening to this man on a big screen. And I felt he was pointing right at me. I remember sitting there and he was talking, and you know how Shambach preaches. And I remember one moment where I was laughing and laughing, you know, what he was saying. And all of a sudden he stopped and he looked at me. He just pointed a finger at me, and said, what are you laughing at, sinner? You're on your way to hell. And that hit me. I was sitting there and it hit me. And I remember the service, amen, at the end, they made an altar call. And I remember, oh, I want to go. But there was other forces coming against me. You're going to make a fool of yourself. You're going to make a mistake. You've got your church. You've got your religion. That's good enough for you. You don't need any more than that. And I remember that fight that took place and I walked out of there. But oh, I struggled. I came back again the next night. The third night, I fought it off for those 3 nights. That conviction. But that one last night, my wife and I went home. And I knew I couldn't fight it any longer. I was sitting in my home, just her and I, the kids were in bed. And I looked at her and I said, Pauline, I believe I need to get saved now. I need to get saved. And she looked at me and I said, how do we get saved? We didn't even know how to get saved. She said, I think there's some tracks that her brother had sent to us. She went running into the bedroom. She pulled out those tracks. On the back of one of those tracks was a little prayer that said, dear Jesus, please forgive me of my sin. Wash me and cleanse me. I said that little prayer, her and I together, in my living room, kneeling beside our coffee table, our kids in bed. And in that moment, I knew something had happened. My life had changed. I didn't know how it had changed, but I knew I was different. And the thing I was afraid of, amen, was being able to say no to that ice cold beer, amen, after hard working day in a coal mine. And I remember that first day I was dreading going to work. Amen. I'll think about it all day. 4 o'clock came. Time to go home. Amen. I was with this, my friend, and sure enough, we got in the car, pulled up to the bar. Amen. He runs in, comes out with an ice pack of 6 cold beer, puts it right beside me. And I'm sitting there looking at that ice cold beer, the beer that I used to love, the beer that I used to just amen, just chug it down, one shot, hallelujah. Amen, the beer that would turn me on, the beer that was my answer, the beer that made life fun, the beer, and all of a sudden, everything in me hated it, detested it. I didn't want no taste of it. Amen, I didn't want nothing of it. Amen, I just begin to thank the Lord, amen, that I knew I was saved, and He had delivered me, and Jesus had set me free. Amen. Hallelujah. May the 22nd, 1984. Amen. When He changed my life. We moved home a year later. There's more to this. I remember the mine manager coming to see me and saying, George, we have plans for you. We want to move you to Hinton, Alberta. We want you to, amen, we want to put you in management. That's what they were telling me. But there was nothing in me that desired that. I just wanted to move home. I didn't know why. Amen. Until 4 years later, 5 years later, when the Lord called me to ministry. And as Pauline said, we started planting a church there on our home reserve. 5 years after we got saved, 1989, we planted a church. The Lord called me into ministry. A Pentecostal church on Moose Factory Island. The year 2000, the Lord called us out to travel. We began to go to these flying reserves. I remember this one reserve. I was the APM director then of the ministry. We had gone into this one. We were doing, they had built a new church, and we were going in there to open, do a grand opening and a dedication of this church building. 2011. I think it was around November that we went in there. We chartered two flights in there. It was a bunch of guys that went in there from the POC, all the head guys. We went in there. And when we did that dedication service, the power of God, the glory of God, I remember filling that place, people dancing and shouting. We were leaving, we were heading to the airport, rejoicing. We got in that plane, there was six of us in that plane. Six of us, two pilots, four passengers. We didn't have no luggage. Amen. And that plane, it was a nice clear night. That plane, amen, I remember going down the runway, as we usually do. Amen. And all of us, that plane began to lift. That plane began to lift and lift, but all of a sudden we could feel a shaking. I didn't know what's going on. Pauline described it as a car, you know, you go off the lane of your highway, you hit the gravel, and it shakes your car. That's what was happening, was shaking. I didn't realize what was going on until we began to realize we were hitting trees. We were hitting trees. The plane did not lift. It had only lifted a few feet, and then we began to hit trees. And I thought, this was it. That's over. We're going to die right here. But Pauline, we grabbed our hands together and we began to speak in that funny language. Ah, hallelujah. Glory to God. We begin to speak in tongues. We begin to call upon God. We begin to say, God, you gave us a promise. We're going to see our grandchildren being raised. We're going to see our grandchildren growing up. God, you gave us a promise. And we begin to call upon God. And all of a sudden that plane began to lift. It began to lift. We didn't know what was going on. I could see those pilots with their flight. It was dark. It was midnight. They were flashing at the wings. And then looking and checking the wings. They didn't tell us anything about what was going on. They just said, we're going to Pickle Lake. There's some damage to the plane. And so we were going to Pickle Lake. I could see the lights of the airport. 18. They said 18 minutes. 18 minutes. That's the longest 18 minutes. See, you don't know what's going on. You don't know if you're going to fall out of the sky or not. 18 minutes, amen. All of a sudden, I could see the lights. I said, oh, we're okay. We're going to make it. I could see the runway, and I could see the plane descending. We're coming down, and we're coming down. I said, oh, we're going to make it. We're going to be okay. All of a sudden, the plane, it began to lift again. I was, what's going on? The pilot turns around. He says, you know what I told you, amen, about that door back there, and fasten your seatbelt. That's all he said. We circled around, we came back, we lined up again. But this time, it wasn't just airport runway lights. There was flashing lights, ambulances, fire trucks. Amen, all lined up on that airport, that little airport strip. Amen, we came in for a landing. Amen, we didn't know the wheels had been damaged and they couldn't lower. So there we were going in for a landing. We landed on the belly of that plane. Amen, the pilot said, when the plane stops, get out and run. Amen, that plane just kept on going and going. Pauline yells out, "Stop in the name of Jesus." Amen. That plane stopped. We swung the door open. Amen. We begin to run out of that plane. Hallelujah. Amen. Now I know why the Pope, amen, kissed the ground whenever he lands. Glory to God. Because that's what I felt like doing in that very moment. Just standing there and kissing and hugging that old ground. Hallelujah. Amen. But that was an isolated reserve. There was a little community. There was no other planes. There was nothing around there. Just that airport. And I thought, that's it. I'm not going to fly again. I'm never getting in a plane again. I don't care. I'm going to call. I tried to call a taxi. Amen. I was trying to call a taxi cab. I was going to go to Sulaka, rent a car. Amen. And go to Thunder Bay where our vehicle was. I wasn't going to get no more planes. And I remember standing in that airport. We were there all night waiting for another flight to pick us up. And then on the wall of that airport, I don't know why that mural was there, but there was a poster there, John Wayne. And it said, when you fall off your horse, you got to get back up in the saddle again. And I kept looking at that thing, and I was talking with the pilots, and the pilot said, "George," he said, "the best thing to do is get back in the plane. Otherwise, you got to overcome this." And I knew I had to do it. And so the next morning, that plane came to take us to where we were heading, to Thunder Bay. The plane landed, amen, and I knew. I said, "Lord, you got to be with me." We got on that plane, took off, landed in Thunder Bay, no problem. I knew the Lord was with us in that very moment. He was there. Amen. He had promised us something. I remember, amen, and I'm going to be finishing with this. We had been scheduled into a place called Sachemo Lake, maybe a year before that. As we were traveling from Thunder Bay, driving on the highway to Sulaka to fly in, it's an hour flight from Sulaka, there was about a snowstorm. It kept snowing and snowing. The snow kept thicker and thicker as we were driving. And I told him, "I don't think we're going to be able to fly today." I told him, "It doesn't look like very good." When we went to the airport, we pulled into the airport. There was no one in the airport except us and the agent. I walked up to the agent. I said, "Is the flight going to be going in?" "I don't know," he says, "but just check in, and if it does, we'll call you. Just wait." We sat in that airport waiting. I don't know how long we waited, a couple of hours. We were supposed to be in there already, but because of the delay, we were scheduled to do a service that night at 7 o'clock, and we were supposed to have been in there by 3 or 4. But now it was delayed. It was now around 6. Finally, they called us and said, "Your flight is ready. Get on the plane." Just Pauline and I were on that plane. We got on the plane, took off, and as we were coming an hour north of Sulakaut, I could see an opening. I could see the place we were going, and I see the plane going into that opening. We landed in Sachigo Lake. We were able to land. The pastor met us. He said, "George," he said, "we'll just go right to the church. I don't think anyone's going to be there." He said, "They're not, because of the storm, I don't think they're going to show up." He said, "But we'll go there anyway and just open the service, and we'll just say a few words, and we'll go home, and we'll have supper, and we'll get ready for tomorrow night." We walked into the service, Pauline and I, the pastor and his wife, four of us. And we opened the church, turned the lights on, and we sat there waiting. Two ladies walked in and sat at the back. Six of us were in there. They handed the service to us. I told Pauline, "Just go sing a song or two, and then I'll get up and we'll pray, and then we'll close the service till tomorrow night." As I was getting up, the Lord spoke to me. He said, "Preach, son, preach, preach." I said, "Lord, you see who's in here. There's four of us here I know are saved. There's two ladies that just came in. There's only six of us here. Preach, son, preach." I preached that night like there was 10,000 people there that night. I preached my heart out. I preached and preached, and then I made an altar call. And those two ladies got up, walked to the front, and gave their hearts to Jesus. The storm continued all through the weekend, all Saturday, Sunday. Monday, they didn't even know if the flight was going to come in to pick us up or not. They said, wait, we'll call you. Sure enough, the afternoon came. They called and said, the flight's coming in. We went to the airport, got on the plane. There were just two of us on that plane. We took off, landed in Sulakot. Pauline and I drove, made it home. That week, the pastor called me. He said, I don't know why I'm calling you, Pastor Gunner. He said, but I just want to let you know, since you've come in and left, you're the only people that have come in and out of Sachigo Lake in the past week. And the Lord spoke to me and said, son, if you're obedient to me, I'm going to be with you. I'll be with you wherever you go. I'll watch over you and I'll protect you. But you have to be obedient to me. And I've seen the hand of God moving. And what I want to tell you is this tonight. The Bible says, what is your life? And there's an old saying that says, there's only one life. It will soon be passed. And only what's done for Christ will last. And when I'm dying, how happy I'll be if the lamp of my life has been burned out for thee. I want to live for God. I want to give everything to him. I thought acquiring things and having a good job was the answer. I thought sobriety was the answer. I thought all of the things, amen, would satisfy me, but there was still something missing in my life. It was Jesus Christ. And there's only one way you're going to know him is when you know him intimately and passionately. When you draw nigh to him, he'll draw nigh to you. Some of you follow God, but you follow him like Peter from afar off. You're following him from way back there when God says, come on, come close to me. I'll talk to you. Amen. I'll show you things. I'll reveal things to you. Hallelujah. Amen. It'll be greater than what you ever had. God has a plan for your life, and it's a plan that's worth living. He preserved me when the devil tried to take me out. Where would I have been had it not been for the Lord? I would have been a drug addict, perhaps, an alcoholic. Amen. Somebody lost. Amen. In a hospital, maybe. In a prison somewhere. Amen. My wife and family gone. Or maybe even in a burning hell. But the grace of God that kept me and brought me out. And today, amen, I stand here. Who am I? I'm a voice in the wilderness. I'm a nobody trying to tell everybody about a somebody that can save anybody. He can put a home together. He can put a marriage together. He can save you. He can bring you out of alcoholism and drug addiction. Jesus Christ can do, amen, what no one else could ever do. He can give you a life worth living. His name is called Jesus. Hallelujah. What is your life tonight? I'm going to ask my wife to come and sing one song. What is your life tonight? Where is it? Are you lost? Are you dying? Do you have Christ in your life tonight? Or is it just something you go through on a Sunday morning? I live and breathe Jesus. It's all you need. It's all that matters. It's to know the Christ. I saw my daddy get saved. Listen to me tonight. I saw my daddy get saved. My daddy was a wicked, cruel, cursing man. Alcoholic who beat his wife. I saw him beat my mother many times. Blood all over the place. I saw that as a boy growing up. But I saw Jesus touch my daddy and change my daddy's life. Hallelujah. To where I saw the glory of God. And you know what my daddy said one day after my mother had passed away? I saw my daddy. He came to me and said, George, why didn't somebody come and tell me about this man called Jesus? He said, all those years I lived in poverty, drunkenness, violence. I lived in sin all those years. He said, the last, they only had 3 months together, him and my wife, before him and my mom, before she passed away. They only had together saved just 3 short months. And he said, those months were the happiest we ever had in our whole life. He was 60 years old when he got saved. What is your life tonight? said, I went to a church for 1 year. They never made an altar call. Until she said, I went to a Pentecostal church. Thank God they make altar calls. And tonight you're in this place. You may be drifting away. You may be lukewarm. You may never have been saved at all. You may be backslidden. But tonight, there's an altar call for you. I'm going to make this one altar call tonight. And I believe tonight, amen, God is touching my heart. Touching someone right now. You feel a tug, a conviction in your soul. That's what I felt that first night I heard the gospel. I heard R.W. Shaw. I felt the conviction and all the battle that would take place. But I'm so glad that 3 nights later, I would bow my knee and confess with my mouth that He is Lord. Stand with me tonight. Everybody stand with me tonight. I want the church to begin to pray. The greatest thing, the hardest thing for you to do is to take that first step and say, Lord, I'm coming home. I'm coming. I'm going to surrender my life. I'm going to give my life to Jesus. But you take that first step and He'll take those next 20 steps with you. He'll be there. He's waiting. He's calling. He's touching your heart right now. Hallelujah. Every eye is closed. One altar call tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Somebody
right now, you know, He's calling you right now. Thank Thank you, Lord.
Happiness.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
And now I know,
yes, Lord.
Jesus touched me, and He made me whole.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus, have your way. Oh, hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. One more call, one more chance, one more opportunity. And then I'm going to ask for those that need a healing touch. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. The greatest miracle is for someone to be born again, to receive eternal life. And the door is open. He's knocking upon the heart of your door, the door of your heart right
come
now.
Come in home.
Sing it together.
Come in home. And yes.
I remember that hour.
Open wide those arms of love.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Say, Lord,
Jesus,
I'm coming home.
There's a call on your life right now.
Coming home.
Somebody, you've been drifting away.
Coming.
You haven't been serving God the way you need to be.
And then
tonight you need to say, yes, Lord, that's me. I'm coming, Lord. I'm coming right now. Step out, step out. Don't be afraid tonight. We're going to pray with you. Hallelujah. We won't embarrass you. We just want to pray with you tonight. Jesus, we got to get it right. We got to make it right. He's coming back. It's time to come home. Spirit of God is touching your life right now. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord.
My uncle went and bought me my bus, bought me this dinner ticket to go down there to the to this old pastor's meeting, dinner and everything else.
Full gospel.
Full gospel. Thank you, uncle.
Thank you.
I went down there just to run the camera and everything else. I was thinking, I'll just run the camera, nothing's going to happen. How many of you all felt like that before? Well, I go down there, and I'm listening to this guy from Moose Factory giving his testimony. I'm like, oh great, he's talking about me. Because, you know, he actually had the same thing that I was doing. Running away from God. There's three people you can never run away from. You cannot run away from God, because wherever you are, because when you're trying to get to your destination, it's only there, so him what took you so long. You can't run away from the devil because he's nipping at the back of your heels. And you cannot run away from yourself because everywhere you are, everywhere you go, there you are. I try to run away from two out of the three. And I looked at it and I was like, this is something that I never really talked about at all. Yes, I did a lot of ridiculous things as a teenager, and I looked at it, I was looking at it, you know what, I'm done with Christianity. When I was 18 years old, I said, I looked at it, I said, I ain't going anywhere. I might as well go in the wilderness. And the next thing I know, I was listening to his testimony, and I was like, this is definitely something that I've been going through, that I've been struggling in my life. I haven't been struggling with the alcohol or the drugs or the smoking or anything else like that, but my type of thing that I was struggling with was Christianity, was the Christian people, because some of them looked down at me from a very young age, and I just kind of looked at it, I was like, I don't want to be like that because I've been there, I've done it, I've seen it. And the next thing you know, he starts talking about people coming forward. And I'm looking at him, I'm like, I want to stick by the camera, I don't want to move. I'm looking at it, I'm saying that to myself. Next thing you know, my feet start moving on its own like this, and I literally try to hold on to the camera. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, no, I am not going to be the first one to go up there. I am not going to be the first one to go up there. Well, sad news is I was the first one up there. First thing came out of my mouth, though, I'm right in the back of my head, I'm like, no, I'm like trying to fight it not to go to the front. I don't know how many of you, if you've ever felt that way where you had to fight your way to the front. And it's not the easiest. Take it from me, it's not easy at all. It's like, no, I don't want to go up to the front. I don't want to go up to the front. It's like deep down inside your brain, you're like, you're not going to win. I'm going to stay right here. I'm not going to go to the front. Well, I ended up being the first one at the front. First thing in my mouth that comes out of me saying, it's me. And I'm looking at it, and the guy looks at me and says, there's one more. I look up at him, and I'm like, Yehovah, what have you been doing to me? Like, you have me by the neck or what? And the amazing part of it was the dinner was great, the music was great, listening to the guy's testimony was even great, and even afterwards, saying hi to Jack and everything else, I even surprised a lot of people who knew me from when I was really short and really small to seeing me like this. Was amazingly funny watching the look on their jaws. Face is like, that can't be the same Jesus that we all know. Well, he grew it. Then my uncle tells the joke saying, oh yeah, he's not done growing yet. What? That lady's look on her face was priceless. And he turns and tells her softly, says, he's not done growing sideways. And seeing my uncle doing that and turning that little pun into it just to make me laugh was priceless. I'm like, yes, I finally got my uncle in a sense of humor. Here I am doing jokes on my uncle, and my uncle pulled a fast one on me. It's not very often you get to see my uncle pull some jokes and have a little fun at the same time. And it shocked me the whole time I was there. I was listening to the pastor there from Lewis Factory there. I do forget his name there, uncle, I'm pretty sure.
George Gunner. Yeah.
I actually ran into him in the bathroom that same night. And we were talking about music. And I said, you know, my dad used to be a drummer at my uncle's church. He also liked to sing and play drums. And he looked at him and says, that's a very unique type of talent. I said, yeah, I said, you know, I'm kind of shocked that I have the same talent as my dad. He kind of looked at me, he's like, what do you mean? I'm like, I love singing and playing the drums myself. But the thing is, I haven't done it as a combination before or ever like that. And I turned around, I looked at it, and I said to myself, when he was putting his hands on me and he was praying, it was the most amazing thing I ever felt. Like, oh yeah, I did feel it. This morning I woke up, I felt like I got hit by a satellite truck and a train at the same time. And I was like, why do I ever feel sore? What happened last night? it was like the love of all there whatsoever, but I felt like I was completely just drained. I slowly gave myself up into composure. I'm like, okay, I know that it could be the water because they had ice cold water that was it. That's all I was drinking. No alcohol left like that, but I felt like I was completely sloshed. Like, I'm pretty sure some people are like, you know, movie beds and stuff like that, where they get completely drained the next day. Like, I watched so many movies, I'm dead tired. Well, that's how I felt like this morning. And I was literally in shock that you could actually feel like that without any alcohol. And I was looking at it this morning, I was like, I feel so stiff, sluggish, and everything else. I'm like, and then people ask me in the morning, saying, how are you feeling, James? I feel like I got hit by a semi and a train at the same time. And just the look on their face was just priceless. And I do have to thank my uncle there for taking me to that meeting there last night. It was well worth the $25. He actually paid my ticket. And he talked with me in that morning. He turned around and asked me, he says, James, have you got anything planned this weekend? Nope. Want to come with us to a dinner? Sure. Are you running the camera? Perfect. No problem. Give me the camera. I'll do it right. I even got the photo of everybody there at the dinner a couple of times, as well as when they were playing music, and I thought, you know, like, I'll zoom in on the music a little bit, slowly zoom out, and pan up the people and everything else. And I did that, which was such an amazing thing, because seeing all the people there that recognized me and knew me for so long, I do have to say, though, like, even if Pastor Jack is watching this, yeah, I know you saw me yesterday, too. And it was lovely to see you and your wife there as well, because I was really surprised. His wife was so surprised at seeing the size of me. She's a sweet, short lady, but boy, was she ever happy to see me. And she hasn't seen me in the longest time ever. And I never, in a million years, would think that, oh, she's going to recognize me. Oh, as soon as I said hi to her, she's like, James? Yeah. Oh boy, you grew. Eyes wide open, and even one of the guys even recognized me and says, hey, that's the guy who picked me up off the ground at the Sudbury Shopping Center. I'm like, ready for another uplifting experience? He's like, no. And we all started laughing. I mean, I didn't mind even teasing Jack. I turned around, I grabbed some snow, I said, hey Jack, where is he? Something cool? He looks at me, he's like, what's that? I started rubbing it on my arm and said, I feel nothing. He's like, what's that? My uncle and sister, my uncle. What planet is James from? He's walking out there with a short sleeve shirt on, not even breezed by the cold. And I'm feeling cold for him. I mean, like, Jack is looking at me, he's like, James, this is the most amazing thing I've ever seen, you know? You You walked away at a young age because you got tired of things, and then all of a sudden, you're walking right back into the same, you're walking right back into the same scene all over again, like, but in a different scenario. Instead of you being considered the villain and the bad guy, you're walking in there like you, you're walking into another part of it where you're like, now I can prove and show how a true Christian is supposed to walk and talk and act. Because I know that there's some fake ones out there. There's some of them that act like they're Christians, they may talk like a Christian, but they're not. And the sad part about it is I've seen in this church, the fake ones and the real ones. And I do know for a fact that there are some true blue ones out there. They're just hard to find. But once you find them, they'll help you whenever you need them.
Amen.
But that is the most amazing part about it is when you find them. Amen. Those are the ones that you should be really getting to really go with God.